Good morning again. Glad to have you worship with us today and looking forward to a great day in the house of the Lord. We have several prayer requests this week that we'll need to update on and pray over, as well as I'm sure there are some praise reports we'll share as well. Before Jason gets seated, we'll get him to give us an update on his mother. You don't have to stand. You just got to speak loud.
My mother is in heart related. She had a bypass. She is alert.
Jason's mom back in IU, isn't it? Is that where she is? St. Vincent's waiting heart bypass. You just said it. My brain is completely messing up. And so I want to remember Jason's mom. Also this week we've had Shirley Jones in some pretty bad shape at St. Vincent, Vincent's heart on the north side. At one point she was flatlined, and she has been treated and is hopefully coming home this weekend for some future testing and going. All came from a rapid heartbeat that they couldn't get under control, and the medication they're using to get under control was for a different condition than what she had, and it took them a while to figure it all out, but Dennis said after a couple of strenuous days, very thankful that she is doing well for now, and they'll continue to treat and try to figure out how to cure that condition. So, the Joneses, yes.
She encouraged her friend Randy Bassett, who was the pastor of Sugar Grove Bible Church. They did put a heart pump in him this week as he's waiting for a transplant. He's still on the ventilator, so.
Yeah. Sarah, how's your brother?
He's a little weaker. He starts chemo again Tuesday, and I'll be going to Tennessee on Tuesday.
Ethan, it's good to have you back with us. We'll move that to the praise side. You have one more treatment? All right. Keep Ethan in your prayers. Other praises this morning.
I got a praise yesterday. My dad got good news from when he had to put in a heart. He doesn't have to go back for another year.
Very good. Very good.
Well, I'm reading on the same chapter but our son's been on the road for a while. I always pray that they'll be safe. Somebody will also go to the hospital. And I have a great niece, my age is 27. She just suddenly got an infection. They don't know what else is good for her. Very critical. So I haven't heard anything in 3 days, but most of
I got a job this week. Been praying for him to have that opening. So praise for that. And the live stream seems to be working. We already got feedback, so. All right. Any others?
Breathless in awe and wonder, the kingdom's only. Jesus' blood and his righteousness stand and we say together.
Thank you.
think I told David wrong. We're also going to be in Matthew chapter 7. So, well, let's start in Luke chapter 6 and verse 48 will be our focal verse as we open the scriptures this morning. We're looking at a foundation today, the foundation actually, Jesus Christ, the rock upon which the strong house is built. And over the next several weeks, we're going to be looking at some foundational principles of our faith and of Christian life, of our church, and those things that we can count on and rely on. One of the things that I came across this week I thought was kind of interesting was a report from a public school that started a class on the Bible as a history class. And the teacher of this class, this is in Massachusetts, I believe, and the teacher of this class began by asking some what we would consider simple questions. And here are some of the results, which is why we need to get back to studying the cornerstone. Who were Sodom and Gomorrah? Well, they were lovers. You notice they weren't whos, right? Those were two cities. Here's another response. The Gospels were written by Matthew, Mark, Luther, and John. Little German gospel going. Eve, you know Adam's wife? She was created from the apple. Jesus was baptized by Moses. And one of the top students in his class answered the question, what was Golgotha with? It was the name of the giant that was slew by the apostle David. We think we live in a Christian community, don't we? Now, this wasn't our community, but I suspect we would get some very similar answers. These kids weren't trying to be funny. They just don't know. The fact that they don't know is not their fault. It's our fault. I had a girl, a college girl, at a church I was working at with in Texas. I was doing college ministry. Alice was on staff as the youth minister at the church. And had a girl come in. Never met her before, didn't know her. Her grandfather was a part of our church. And she came to our Bible study. And after a couple of weeks, she stayed around after and she said, you make references to all these stories in the Bible. She says, I don't know any of those stories. I said, what do you mean you don't know those stories? She said, we're talking about things like David and Goliath. She said, yeah, I had to go home and ask my grandpa to tell me about it because I'd never heard it before. This is a grandchild of a faithful, lifelong church member who had never heard the most basic stories of a Christian faith. It was not her fault. She said, what can I do to begin to learn some of this? You know what I told her? I said, go get you a children's Bible and start reading the stories. A Bible storybook. Begin to get some foundations. Once you build the foundations, we will feel the meat on those bones with the scriptures. But you're starting from behind and we've got to catch you up. Our world is starting from behind and we're running away instead of helping to catch them up. This wasn't a funny thing. It was a real thing and it's a concerned thing. We've forgotten what the foundation is. We've forgotten who the foundation is. I know I'm preaching on a Sunday morning to the church people. I know the 8 o'clock service knows this or you wouldn't already get up so early. But I want you to understand that we know it's not enough. You're not going to be judged by what you know, but what you do with what you know. You'll be judged on who you know, that is Jesus. He's the cornerstone. He's the foundation. He's the rock upon which everything else is built. The who you know is the most important thing. But you will never be judged on what you know, but on what you do. That you know. It's said that in the old days, they would build the churches at the center of town. And they'd put a big clock on the tower so that everyone in town would know what time church started and they wouldn't be late. Now, you know what they want? They want a clock on the back wall so the pastor knows what time to let you go so you won't be late. Get out of here. Now 2 weeks in a row, I'll let you go on time or early. Don't get used to that. One last story. Then we'll get into the scripture. And this story will set up the scripture for this morning. You know what a counterfeit bill looks like? Money. So, if I give you a $100 bill and you don't know that it's counterfeit and I did a good job, probably wouldn't, but just say I did. I gave you a $100 bill, you think it's a real $100 bill, which your first clue should be that I gave it to you. That should be the first clue. Alright? And you take that $100 bill and you go to the gas station and you buy gas and you give them that $100 bill. It's a great thing, right? You get your gas, you go on your merry way. You didn't mean to defraud them. I didn't mean to defraud you. That gas station attendant then gives that $100 bill to a vendor who's selling some of the stuff in the store. And that vendor then goes and he gives it to his boss. His boss turns around and gives it to somebody else. And eventually that $100 bill makes its way to the bank. And somebody's trying to deposit that $100 bill. And the banker says, "We got a problem. This is a fake. And I can't give you the deposit." Now, did that $100 bill fail to spend in any of those other places? Did those who used it fail to receive whatever it was they were exchanging that $100 bill for? No. Sometimes it's that way with our faith. Sometimes we go about doing good for no good reason. And later we find out that it's a fake, that we're a fraud. And that what we thought we were doing has no value. It doesn't mean it didn't help somebody along the way. It doesn't mean that it wasn't powerful in the moment. I guarantee you, if you go knock on doors in our community, you're going to find a lot of good people who do a lot of good things. And you're going to hear a lot of talk about, well, if you're asking me why I think I'll go to heaven, it's because I've done more good than I've done bad. I've tried to be a good person. And you know what that four-letter word good does? It spins well, doesn't it? It accomplishes a little bit here and a little bit there throughout our society. But one day, the scripture says, we are all going to die and face judgment. And God's not going to ask how good you were. Some of us are going to be found to be counterfeit. And a lot in our community are going to be found to be counterfeit. And God's going to say, it doesn't really matter all the good deeds you did. If you don't know my son Jesus, you don't get into my house. Last night, Hannah had a friend come over. She spent the night at our house. When she came to the door, she rang the doorbell. And the dogs went crazy. That's what they did. And we let her in. Why? Because she knew my child. She was received and invited by my child. Now God gave us Jesus, his child. Scripture says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son that whosoever believes in him will not perish but will have eternal life. God said through Jesus, his son, that if anyone wants to get into his father's house in heaven, they must come through him. That he is the only way, the only truth, and the only life. Now I added the word only there. What he said was, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father unless he comes to the Son. If you want to get in the house of the Father, you can't just be good. You must know the cornerstone. Open your Bibles if you haven't already. Luke chapter 6. God's going to give us an example of two builders. They're going to build their houses. They have a lot in common. They both want out of the weather. They both want a nice house. They both are going to do the work of building. But join me in verse 46. I'll look at these two builders real quick. He says, why do you call me Lord, Lord, and don't do the things I say? I will show you what someone is like who comes to me, hears my words, and acts on them. He is like a man building a house, who dug deep and laid the foundation on the rock. And when the flood came, the river crashed against the house, and it couldn't shake it, because it was well built. But the one who hears and does not act is like a man who built his house on the ground without a foundation. The river crashed against it, and immediately it collapsed, and the destruction of the house was great. Now listen as I read the end of the Sermon on the Mount out of Matthew chapter 5, Matthew chapter 7, a very similar passage. Jesus starts in verse 21 of Matthew 7 saying, "Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only he who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. Many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name? And in your name drive out demons and perform many miracles? Then I will tell them plainly, I never knew you. Away from me, you evildoers. Therefore, whoever hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on a rock. The rain came down, the streams rose, the winds blew and beat against the house, yet it did not fall, because it had its foundation on the rock. But everyone who hears these words and does not put them into practice is like a foolish man who built his house on the sand. The rain came down, the streams rose, the winds blew and beat against the house, and it fell with a great crash. And when Jesus had finished saying these things, the crowds were amazed at his teaching, because he taught as one who had authority and not as one of their teachers of the law." Passages are very similar. Passages both start with the idea of, why do you call me Lord, Lord, and do not do what I say? And Matthew says, those who say Lord, Lord, are not everyone who says Lord, Lord will get to enter the kingdom of heaven. There are a lot of counterfeits out there, and we have convinced ourselves we're the real thing. We had a daycare girl some years ago who thought she was a horse. Now, she wasn't crazy. She didn't have a psychological issue. She didn't really think she was a horse. But all she did was whinny and gallop and play horse. Everywhere she went, she was a horse. When you would ask her, "Are you a horse or a little girl?" she'd tell you she's a horse. But no matter how hard she tried, no matter how long her mane grew, her ponytail got, she could never be a horse. Because she was created to be a little girl. Now there is one way to transform yourself, and only one way to be transformed. God says if you believe in Jesus, you are no longer who you once were, but you're dead to that self. And you are rebirth born. You get new life. You are transformed into a new creation. See, we leave the citizenship of this world and we gain citizenship of heaven with God, our Father, for eternity. But it's about to be built upon the solid rock who is Jesus. See, not all who say, Lord, Lord, will get to go to heaven. Not all who do good are Christians or good people. But only those who have entered according to God's plan and prioritize the rock of our salvation. Now, one of the things that these two builders, the foolish and the wise, have in common is they're both building. We have something in common with them as well. We are building. Did you know that? You're building a legacy as you build your life. You're building your life, what you will live, but you're also building a legacy that others will see. What they see and observe about your life, what they will take away from their observations about your life. We're all building something. The question is, what is the foundation? Who is the foundation? We need to look at this foundation and what it does for us. The foundation of Jesus. Because the builder didn't just start building. The wise builder, rather, didn't just start building. The foolish one did. The wise builder cleared the ground. He dug deep. He sought out the right place to place his house. This house that he's going to build on this solid rock, this strong foundation. going to provide him shelter. It's going to provide him rest. It's going to provide him safety. It's going to provide him a home for his family, companionship with friends. But he starts, because he wants it to last, with some hard work. I don't know about you guys, but I kind of happened into learning how to be a parent. I had good parents, don't get me wrong. I had good training from my parents. But my sister, much smarter than I, the least educated and the most successful in our family, she went to the library. And she started checking out books. And she started reading and learning about parenting. That makes a whole lot more sense, doesn't it? Than waiting until you make mistakes, because you really don't want to make mistakes raising your kids. But turn out like Hannah. She's in here with me this morning. No, she did the wise thing. She planned what she was going to do. She spent time and energy and hours reading and studying and learning. It's a much better way to go about it. We got teachings from the scriptures that teach us how to be good parents. We got learning that's available to us in the Bible for almost every facet of life. But how often do we really dig deep and get to the truth upon the rock upon which we'll build our foundation? See, the wise builder, he dug deep so that his shelter, his rest, his safety, his place of companionship would be set firm and would last through the storms of life. They asked Peter one time, Jesus actually asked all the apostles, and Peter was the one who answered, "Who do the people say that I am?" And the people said, top answer on the board, "You're a prophet. You're a good teacher." They had some pieces of the puzzle right. Jesus says, "Okay, Peter, who do you say that I am?" What was Peter's answer? "You are Messiah, the Christ of God, the Holy One. You are the Christ." Jesus tells Peter, "You have answered rightly. And upon this rock, I will build my church." What's the rock? The rightness of Jesus as Messiah. If we're going to build a house, a life, a church, it's got to start on the cornerstone. It's not easy to dig deep. It's not easy to clear the ground. It's not easy. It takes time. It takes energy. And oftentimes it takes others coming alongside us to get the job done. But that extra time, that extra energy is worth it when the storm comes. I used to do some roofing in Texas. I lived in Dallas. I went to seminary in Fort Worth. Roofing Company. Fort Worth was known for hailstorms, which was great for roofing. Fort Worth was also known for summer droughts. I will tell you this without a shadow of a doubt, we were the absolute best roofer, 100% dry during the droughts. You know the problem? Anybody can put a good roof on during a drought, because there's no water to test the work that was done. But you know what Dallas is also known for? Storms. Floods, flash floods coming through. What happens if I put your roof on in June during the beginning of the drought, 76 days later, which was one of the summers that I was there? The rains finally come. And I did a great job as long as the drought was on. But the rains come and the winds blow and your shingles are all over the place and your kitchen floor, living room floor, is now full of water. Now, that didn't happen to us, thank the Lord. But what would happen if you thought you were protected and you thought you were well cared for because you were living drought. But the storms will come. The question isn't how will you do when everything's on the level. The question is not how will you do when you don't have enough people. The question is, how are you going to do when the storms come? You know they don't build bridges for 70-degree weather and no winds. They build bridges to withstand hurricanes. Why? You don't have a hurricane every day. When I worked in the body shop back in college, my boss was really fond of saying, it's back during when all the testing for safety started going on, back in the 90s, and it was everybody was focused on safety ratings. He said the purpose of a car is not to wreck. If you're buying a car for the purpose of wrecking, you're not buying the right car. Now, he wasn't opposed to safety. He wasn't opposed to things being secure. But what's the reality of the manufacturer's perspective? When the storm comes, I want you to know that I prepared. God has given us a plan to keep us safe when the storm comes. His name is Jesus. Not only does He save us from our sins and seal us for eternal life in heaven, but He also says, according to the Scripture, that He will send His Comforter to dwell in us, the Holy Spirit, who will guide us through this life. And the Scripture tells us that He who is in us is greater than he who is in the world. He's the one who protects us. He's the one who's there when the winds blow and the floods come. He's the one who makes sure that our lives are protected for our eternity in heaven. Now, it doesn't say we won't go through the storms. It doesn't say we won't have a flood come and beat against us. See, this guy who built on solid ground, he says, I'll show you, verse 47, what someone is like who comes and he hears my words and he acts on them. He's like a man who dug deep. And when the flood came, so the floods are still coming, he just has protection. When the flood came and the river crashed, but it couldn't shake the house because it was well. Foundation you need. If you don't know Jesus, you need to know Jesus. If you've not made Him Lord of your life, you need to make Him Lord of your life. He is the only foundation that will get you through the tough times of life. He is the only source of true and eternal knowledge. He's the only one who has the right answer every single time. Three common things that Jesus says about the wise builder. Comes to him as Savior. The wise builder seeks out the rock. He digs, searches until he finds it. When he recognizes the Savior, the rock, he hears His truth. He begins to build using the teachings of the great teacher. The recorded force of Scripture. The building blocks of our house of faith are the words of God. Old and New Testament, beginning to end, the words of God, absolutely true. We need to hear what Jesus has taught, what He has affirmed. And we need to obey. Faith without works is dead. We need to obey. Had he not obeyed and taken the teachings of the truth of Scripture and built his house, there was building that took place. That's obedience, steps of righteousness for his name's sake. When we build and obey, so we come as to the Savior, we hear his teachings, we learn about the foundations that are given to us in Scripture, we build, we obey our Master, then we will not fall to the curse of the unwise builder. And there is a curse that comes to the unwise builder because he didn't take the time to begin well. And if we don't take the time to begin well, we will have problems. Because he built upon the top of the soil, not on the rock. And the rock is our foundation. When you build on the soil will begin to shift. And as the soil shifts, as the waves hit it and the rains come down, our house will begin to twist and turn, and pressures will be put on it until eventually it will collapse. And it will be useless. We have a lot of things that happen between that rock and building on the ground, don't we? A lot of things we got to dig through in order to get it right. Sometimes we think it's just easier just to keep on going, just to live as we are. It's kind of like the story of the three little pigs, isn't it? Sometimes we got to overcome sin. Almost always we have to overcome sin. Pride. Lifestyle habits. I don't want to quit doing that. If I receive Jesus, I won't be able to keep doing some of the things I did. Relationships. I can't hang out with that person anymore if I'm going to follow Jesus because they're going to pull me down. Past failures. Sometimes we got to get over ourselves, don't we? We're our own worst enemy. That goes with pride sometimes. Fears. There's a lot of things that stand between us and the rock. We got to move past all those things. We've got to choose the rock and we've got to build well. If we don't, we're going to have problems. They both built. They both had a house. And in the good times, you probably couldn't tell the difference. But then, the storms came. Verse 49. But the one who hears and does not act is like a man who built his house of ground without a foundation. The river crashed against it, and immediately it collapsed. Doesn't take long, does it? Our best efforts put to shame. You ever try building a house of cards? How high can you get? You get the first level, right? Can you get the second level? It gets a little more difficult. What about the third level? And then you get so excited, you say, Mom, come and look, and she opens the door, and what happens? The winds blow, and the house immediately crashing. We do that so often in life. We try to do things the easy way, the simple way, the quick way, rather than doing things God's way. We love the why question, don't we? Well, God, why? I don't think why was a part of God's vocabulary. God's kind of like our parents were. You remember what your parents used to say, right? You were raised about the same way I was. Because I said so. Because I made that mistake when I was a kid. Kids, listen, this is the translation. Because I made that mistake when I was a kid and I learned the lesson from it and I know what's going to happen to you and I don't want you to suffer the way I suffered. So I'm telling you the best way to do it so that you don't have to go through what I went through. I love you so much, I want to help you. Now, parents, you know what kids say, right? Let me make my own mistakes. You got to make yours. And this doesn't make any sense. If I cut my hand off and tell you it hurts, and you say, no, it doesn't, I'm going to cut mine off to prove it. You got two main people. And nobody's helped by it. Yeah, it sounds foolish, right? But that's what we do to ourselves by saying, no, I'm not going to listen to you. I'm going to do it my own way. Now, parents, we do have to give our kids a chance to become who God created them to be. Prayerfully, we've got to help them along that way. But we do have to guide them. Kids, you need to listen. There are people who have traveled that path before you. You know, people who will travel that path after you. You will learn from some and you will share with others. God, in His wisdom, in creation, chose to send His Jesus at the right time. God chose to make Jesus the rock, the cornerstone, the foundation of our salvation, our eternity in heaven, and our life on earth. We are all building something. The question is, upon what and upon who are you building? Are you going to clear the dirt first, get rid of the sin? Are you going to take the time to get the right materials? Make sure your house is well built and constructed so that it will stay together. Or are you going to pass counterfeit bills around? Things that look good, it may get you by for a while, but really have no ultimate security. Eventually it gets back to the bank. The banker is God. He says, I don't recognize you as one of mine. You have no value. And you say, but I spent it here, and they spent it there, and it came to me after I did a good work. And he flips out, I do not recognize you. You are not welcome. God has called us to uncover the wrong, confess our sins. He is faithful and just to forgive us and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. Heaven is big enough that all who will confess Jesus as Lord will be saved. God's love is expansive enough that if you'll call upon the name of Jesus, you'll be saved. But if you're going to build upon the rock, it's more than a name. He's a Lord. He's the Lord. He's my Lord. And I hope he'll become yours. Maybe you say, but I've already started building my house and I didn't uncover the foundation first. You know what? God provides a service for that. He'll help you. He will establish that foundation wherever you are today. It says not that you have to be clean to be saved, but while you were yet sinners, Christ died for you. He will save you wherever you are. He will place the rock under your foundation. He will place the rock as your foundation under what you are building. He will teach you how to build properly upon that foundation. But you've got to receive Jesus. The only way to heaven. The only way to where God is calling us. The only way to true happiness, joy, peace, comfort. The only way to salvation. But remember, it's not just who you know. Who you know gets you into heaven. Who are you going to tell? What are you going to do? How are you going to serve as you go? See, it's both pieces working together. You get saved out of the grace of God. You don't do anything for that. He gives that to you. Because He saved you, He wants you to share this good news. He wants you to teach others. He wants you to go and to be a witness to the changed life that He's given you. He doesn't want people showing up saying, Lord, Lord. He doesn't want to have to say to them, I do not know you. But what He really wants is us to say yes, Jesus, and us to help others to say yes, Jesus. So that when we get to heaven, He'll be able to welcome us all with open arms. Where are you this morning as we come to time of response and invitation? Do you know the rock of salvation? Do you know the foundation upon which to build your house of faith, your family of faith? Have you walked in faithfulness? If not, you make today the day? Will you make today the day? Will you say, Jesus, I'm a sinner and I don't deserve you, but I receive you as Lord of my life and I commit to follow you for the rest of my life. I want you to be my foundation. I want you to be the rock upon which I build. God will always give you that request. He will answer it. He loves you and wants you to tell him. You've already committed yourself to Jesus, but maybe you've begun to wander and you need to get back right. Will you just say, God, I want to regain the right to live in a house built on a foundation. Now, God's never tossed you out. He's never rejected you. He's prepared a place for you in heaven that you lose. But are you willing to live like it? If you need to come for baptism, walking in obedience with Jesus Christ, if you need to come for church membership, the altar is going to be open. You have an opportunity to respond to God. You have an opportunity to build on the foundation of Jesus. Question is, how will you respond? Like the wise one, or like the Father God, we do thank you. That we've had the privilege of hearing your word, being in your house. And now, Lord, we ask simply, help us to respond. Give us the confidence, give us the courage to hear your voice and to respond that you would be glorified. Father, we ask that Jesus is lifted up and exalted today through our response. That our lives be furthered in their progression, in their path toward building our house of faith. Some starting with foundation, others continuing to build. Lord, help us all to walk in faithfulness with you as we go forward. We ask this in Jesus' name. If you need to respond, I'll be here at the front to receive you. Will you stand with us? We're going to sing.
Provide for us. You are the rock. So
of our salvation, that we trust in you.